Good evening, everyone. I want to thank you all for attending this evening's session and, of course, to thank our hosts and organizers. This evening, the panel discussion is on protests in Iran and the role of the opposition. We have a very distinguished panel, and I'll be introducing our speakers in a moment. But I've been asked first to provide a few introductory comments on our topic. I thought it would be most useful to start by providing some historical perspective on where we are today, at this particular moment in time, by revisiting where we have been only a few short years ago, and the significant progress that has been made by the democratic opposition to the regime in Tehran. When I was first asked to become involved with this project, more than 3,000 members of the MEK were being held virtual prisoners in a camp inside Iraq, Camp Ashraf. The conditions there were oppressive. These courageous individuals, both men and women, had risked their lives to help the United States when it entered the country to liberate the Iraqi people from Saddam Hussein. For their efforts, they were repeatedly threatened by members of the Iraqi government who were acting as proxies for the Iranian regime. And on at least three occasions, these unarmed, defenseless people were brutally attacked and murdered by the agents of Iran. The survivors were subsequently moved to another camp inside Iraq, the misnamed Camp Liberty. There, they were also subjected to inhumane treatment and periodic mortar attacks. Today, these brave men and women have been relocated outside of Iraq, beyond the immediate reach of Iran, in Albania, where they enjoy the protection of the Albanian government, which continues to resist efforts by Tehran to do harm. A few short years ago, the MEK was listed as a terrorist group by the U.S. State Department. Both Democratic and Republican administrations refused to examine the underlying evidence, thereby perpetuating the slander. The American and international media were all too willing to repeat this lie, that the MEK were terrorists, and that anyone who supported them was complicit with terrorism. Yet today, the truth has prevailed, and the MEK has been removed from the terrorism list. This is a great victory for the democratic opposition and a blow to the mullahs in Tehran. Almost a decade ago, the people of Iran rose up and took to the streets to protest an election that they thought was corrupt and stolen from them. They were brutally repressed by the regime. And for years, the protests have been sporadic, with the Iranian people either too intimidated or too fatigued to take to the streets. But in the last few months, we've seen a change. All over Iran, we have seen protests erupt spontaneously, protesting the endemic corruption, protesting the economic mismanagement, protesting the support for foreign adventures in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Yemen, and elsewhere, instead of investing in their own people at home. The fear of the regime is diminishing, and the people are once again finding their voice. A few years ago, Rudy Giuliani and John Bolton were private citizens, members of the American delegation, seeking justice for the MEK and a better future for all the people of Iran. Today, both men are in the White House, at the epicenter of power, close advisors to President Donald Trump. They know the justice of this cause and have seen firsthand the quiet dignity of Madame Rajavi. And today, President Trump has clearly marked out a different U.S. policy towards Iran, one that is calling them to account for their nuclear weapons and ballistic missile programs, their ongoing support for terrorism and insurrections around the region, and their massive violation of human rights at home. And the President's Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, has stated that, quote, "The bet that the nuclear deal would increase Middle East stability was a bad one for America, for Europe, for the Middle East, and indeed for the entire world. It was clear that it did not end Iran's nuclear ambitions, nor did it deter its quest for regional hegemony." So the Trump administration has reinstated previous sanctions against Iran and developed new ones to hinder their nuclear weapons and ballistic missile programs, to block the financing of terror, and to raise the costs of their destabilizing behavior across the region. This is a very different message from America, with very different policies than just a few years ago. Finally, a decade ago, Madame Rajavi was largely unknown in the United States, Europe, and the world. Today, she is widely respected as the determined and principal inspiration behind the leading democratic opposition movement. I, for one, cannot wait for her to visit the United States and outline her vision. Outline her vision for a new Iran that ends the corruption, creates jobs for Iran's young people, respects the rights of all its people, and wants to play a constructive role in building a new Middle East. This is remarkable progress, and in a very short period of time, the momentum has clearly started to shift. It is increasingly on the side of those who want a democratic representative Iran that can take its rightful place among the great cultures and countries of the world. Credit must go, first and foremost, to Madame Rajavi and the members of the NCRI in America, here in France, and all over the world, who have kept faith in this cause and worked tirelessly to bring to light the injustices of the Iranian regime and deliver the hopeful message that there is another, better way forward. Congratulations to all of you. So now, let's turn to the future. Because all of your hard work has created important new opportunities, opportunities that you now must seize to move your cause forward. With a new president in the White House and a new policy towards Iran, the Democratic opposition now has an opportunity to reintroduce itself to the United States. This opportunity is likely to present itself only one time, and you must make the most of it. Many in America will rally to your cause, I am confident, if you can persuade them of your democratic credentials, your desire for a better future for all the people of Iran, an Iran that should be guided by the 10 principles articulated by Madame Rajavi. But the rules are now going to be changing for you. You are now going to be subject to far greater scrutiny than before, and you have to be thoughtful and strategic about how you present yourselves and your program. For example, we all know that there are those in the media and elsewhere who will allege that you are not a legitimate opposition movement at all, but a cult. Or perhaps worse, that you are still a terrorist organization. They will try to diminish you and distort what you have to say. This cannot be allowed to happen. The good news is that you have many friends on your side, here on our panel and throughout America and Europe, who all want a better future for the Iranian people. We all want to help. We all want to see you and all the people of Iran enjoy the benefits of égalité, fraternité, and liberté. That is the goal, and we are today closer than ever before to realizing it. I would now like to introduce the distinguished members of our panel this evening. We have the great fortune of having Michael Mukasey, the former U.S. Attorney General. The former Director of the FBI, Louis Free. The Honorable John Baird, the former Foreign Minister of Canada. Yves Bonnet, the former governor and head of France's Internal Security Service. Strawn Stevenson, who has worked tirelessly on behalf of the NDP. And Sidi Ahmed Ouzzali, the former prime minister of Algeria. So if we may start with the Attorney General, Mr. Mukasey, for some introductory comments.
Okay. We are indeed at a very hopeful time. And I think, though there are dangers lurking if we're not careful, even as to this gathering, one report said that Speaker Gingrich and Mr. Giuliani were going to be addressing a controversial group. The problem with reporters is that they when they go to write a story about something they don't know very much about, and that's most things, they have a tendency to simply read the file. And so they're going to read the past clips and report what had been reported before. And so I can't stress strongly enough what Mitchell Reese said about the need to make it clear who we are and what we stand for, and that this organization is something different from what has been portrayed. So far as the uprisings in Iran, there is a material difference between what we saw before and what we see now. These are widespread. They are not confined to Tehran. They didn't start in Tehran. They are widespread throughout the country, and that is an enormously hopeful sign. In a perverse way, I think it may very well be that we owe a debt of gratitude, albeit a left-handed compliment, to the former President of the United States, who gave the Iranian government an enormous amount of money in connection with the JCPOA. And the population of Iran now sees that that money is not going into the economy, has not gone into the economy. They have seen no benefit from it. Instead, it's gone both to line the pockets of the people who oppress them and also in support of foreign adventures. And when you see the slogans at these uprisings, which are focused on telling the Iranian regime, we're not interested in Lebanon, we're not interested in the problems of the Palestinians, we're interested in the problems here, and we want the money used here. That is a very hopeful sign, and what it shows is the communication in Iran is alive and well. I think one thing that we could do that would be helpful would be to provide people in Iran with means of communication so that they can get the message out to one another and throughout the country, and keep this tide going.
Thank you. Louis.
Yeah, thank you, Mitch. It's a pleasure to be here with you, and thank you for your commitment, and particularly, I think all the members of the panel want to thank the young men and women, all the men and women in Iran who are, once again, coming to the battlefronts of liberty and leading the cause that's been supported so well here by the MEK. But I agree with Mitch that this is really a historic moment. I think there are a set of circumstances existing now that have never existed before, and it presents a very unique opportunity to break through the resistance to change and to democracy, and the MEK has been the catalyst for this. Monday passed this week, as you probably know, was the 22nd anniversary of the Khobar Tower bombings. 19 Americans and dozens and dozens of Saudis were murdered by that attack, which was a IRGC attack, which funded the Hezbollah in the Eastern Province to launch that attack against the United States, which ironically was enforcing the no-fly zone over southern Iraq. So what has changed and what has not changed? The regime and the IRGC continues to export terrorism, whether it's in Syria or Yemen or Iraq or the Gaza. That has not changed. All of the pressure that's being put on the regime, both internally and externally by the resumption of the U.S. sanctions, has not changed or deterred the primary goal of exporting terrorism. However, the command and control of the regime has begun to deteriorate very seriously. It's not just the students and academics who are upset and expatriates. As the Attorney General said, the anger and the activity and the courage being shown in the bazaar in Tehran, the capital city, is absolutely amazing. These are the shopkeepers, the backbone and the spine of the Iranian economy, and they are angry. Why are they angry? Well, it costs 64,000 rials now to catch a dollar transaction. That's deteriorated from 40% just over the last few months and continues to get worse. The resumption of sanctions is a key change and a key catalyst. We're finding out more and more about the deficiency and really the impropriety of the agreement that was struck by the last administration with respect to Iran. We found out just this week in the Washington Post that there was a secret arrangement where the Secretary of the Treasury, Jacob Lew, got OFAC to grant a license, and tried to coerce two American banks into doing dollar transactions with the regime. Very wisely, the two banks refused. And of course, the administration lied to the Congress about whether there was a side deal with respect to that. So the sanctions are back, and the impact is immediate. Not only won't Nike give cleats to the national team, but Total has pulled out of the South Pars 2 project, despite what their government would like them to do. Daimler, Siemens, all the other companies will not take the risk of violating the secondary sanctions. In Total's case, Total is a great test case. Total is a huge multinational French company, but 90% of its transactions are financed by U.S. banks, and 30% of its shareholders are Americans. So that board, despite what the Paris government would encourage them to do, is not going to violate those sanctions. I think the combination of all these things at the same time is a very, very unique opportunity. And like any struggle, but particularly a struggle where people's lives have been lost and are at risk, it's really the time to push forward with confidence, with persistence, and with a vision. And I think part of that vision is getting Mrs. Rajavi over to Washington, D.C. I don't think a lot of planning is needed. She can do that standing on her head because she has the charisma, the personality, the intelligence, and the reasons to win her case in the United States. By the way, conditions will never be better for her to come to the United States. I don't think there's much risk of her not getting a visa. And many of the people on this panel will be there to greet her and to take her around the United States so the American people can see so the American people and everybody in every village and town in Iran will see the face and the spirit and the heart of democracy impersonated and exemplified by Mrs. Rajavi better than anyone else. So that's my elevator speech. We're going to talk about that this weekend. But it's an exciting time. It's a dangerous time, as the Attorney General said. But the people who are here this weekend have not shown any fear of danger or any reluctance to act. And I think now is the time to act and act boldly. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you. John, over to you.
Well, thank you. Friends, it's great to be with you. I was asked, you know, why are you going to Paris? And I said, well, it's that time of year where pro-democracy activists from around the world come together to support the Iranian people, and for me to give a speech tomorrow with my annual drumming of the mullahs. Someone else. I have met so many great friends, people of Iranian background, people from here in France, from the United States, from around the world, and I'm so pleased to stand in solidarity with you and with the Iranian people. The people of Iran will remember who was with them in these darkest hours, these past 3 years. Why does it matter that people from around the world who come together and share the same values, freedom, human rights, democracy, the rule of law, tolerance, pluralism. Why does it matter that we speak to the people of Iran, whether it's online or through video right now? I had the opportunity to meet Natan Sharansky. Natan Sharansky was a Soviet refusnik, and he was sitting in a gulag somewhere in Saudi Arabia being held in prison by the then Soviet Union.
Siberia.
What did I say?
Saudi Arabia, sorry.
I love the Saudis, no. Don't tell Prince Turkey I said that. Wow. Thank goodness I was friends. But he was sitting in that prison, he was sitting in that gulag, and an American president had the courage and the guts to reject the foreign policy establishment. An American president had the courage and the guts to push aside the advice that he got from the State Department. An American president named Ronald Reagan had the courage to say that the Soviet Union was an evil empire. And when they heard that, languishing in that gulag, it gave them hope. It gave them courage, it gave them strength to soldier on, to seek a better way. And in many ways, that's what we're all doing here, is to give hope to the people of Iran. You know, Iran has a phenomenal history. It has a phenomenal culture. It has the potential to take its place, its rightful place, as one of the leading nations of the world. It has great people, great education, and great potential, great natural resources. The only thing holding the people of Iran back are the mullahs, and we must come together to stand with the people of Iran. Our challenge is to inspire these disparate parts of the opposition in some 142 communities, whether it's those who are oppressed because of the poor economic conditions and deteriorating economic conditions, whether it's those fighting the political battle in Tehran, whether it's on a bridge in Tehran, in a market in Tehran, or throughout the country, we must rally these people to come together and fight for a better life, a better quality of life, and a better future for their country. When change comes, the change will happen very, very quickly, and I am convinced that a brighter day lays ahead for the people of Iran. And when it happens, all of us will be able to say we played a small part in making that happen. Thank you so much.
Thank you, John.
If Madame Rajavi is a leader of a cult, sign me up.
Thank you, John. Monsieur Bonnet.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you,
si vous
Mr.
le permettez,
President,
je vais vous parler de la relation entre les États-Unis et l'Iran. Je commencerai par vous dire que c'est la première fois depuis 65 ans qu'un président américain comprend quelque chose sur l'Iran. Nous avons une expression en France qui dit « tout baigne dans l'huile ». Effectivement, toute la relation entre les États-Unis et l'Iran
it's all right in oil, we say, and in the relationship between the United States and Iran, it's the same. It's all right with oil, and in a true democracy as ours, we have all the keys to understand the ideology and the voice and the actions of the PMOI.
Qui partagent les mêmes vues, qui partagent les mêmes principes, n'a rien compris. Et a fait depuis 65 ans exactement le contraire de ce qu'il fallait faire. Alors aujourd'hui, Monsieur le Président, les Français se moquent de Monsieur Trump.
Now French are mocking President Trump, the French media especially, but also the politicians.
So
I will be the first to say that it's the first American president who understands something about foreign affairs and in particular about the Middle East and in particular Iran. I will be brief, but I would like to remind you that when Dr. Mossadegh in a very legitimate approach, decided to nationalize the Anglo-Iranian company, that is, to put an end to Britain's ownership of Iranian oil. The Americans, in particular CIA, which is not your service, but they built a coup, and Dr. Mossadegh
far, and he was a Democrat, and the Americans had no idea about that. Then, again, the American, with the help of Israelis, helped the Shah, who was, very objectively speaking, a dictator. Of course, compared to the Mullah, he could be a moderate, but he was a dictator. They helped the Shah
and par la force et to en rule ils ont répondu the à country by force,
and they helped him when all other regimes had
de son pouvoir.
Force,
et lorsqu'en
a military
1965,
and when in 1965,
de jeunes intellectuels iraniens ont décidé de se dresser contre le pouvoir féodal du Shah d'Iran, ils ont trouvé en face d'eux cette
power,
police politique
they were
formée par les services américains et les services israéliens.
Military force. Who was supported by the Americans
and the Israelis.
The Americans continued to support the Shah,
le Shah until with the veuille, à juste titre d'ailleurs, entrer dans la voie
turmoil
du
of petroleum,
civil,
they decided, the Shah decided
militaire.
To turn
là,
towards
nuclear, évidemment, un coup d'arrêt donné par les États-Unis
nuclear power,
et par l'Occident.
And then the Americans and all other Western countries united to,
à cette volonté
of course,
du Shah de s'émanciper.
This,
ça a été le sommet de la Guadeloupe, un pays que je connais bien,
puisque
j'en ai été le préfet, et la décision prise par Jimmy Carter
Guadeloupe
de laisser
summit,
tomber le Shah.
I was there, and
les États-Unis n'ont pas été très brillants dans cette affaire, la France n'a
really
pas été plus brillante,
France
s'est
no
better. The Shah qui was un courage qui s'appelait Sadat,
considered
accueil
as nobody, and someone named Sadat welcomed this person because no one else wanted to deal with him. But the Americans
les services américains,
had made
pour mettre
a
au
deal
pouvoir une
to,
hiérarchie avec. L'Ayatollah Khomeini, dont tout le monde pensait
to,
qu'il était podagre et gâteux,
Khomeini, Ayatollah,
et Mehdi Bazargan,
as an Ayatollah and Mehdi Bazargan,
à Téhéran, l'autre à Rome,
one in Tehran,
l'ennui c'est
and
que
the other
celui
one
qui était à Rome,
Rome
ne s'est pas contenté
but the one in Rome
de rester à Rome, et il est
didn't just stay there,
venu
and
à Téhéran.
Very quickly moved back to Tehran.
Vous connaissez ensuite l'histoire
you know
avec des épisodes
next,
qui sont, je crois, douloureux pour la fierté américaine.
Very,
l'invasion ou l'envahissement, comme on voudra, de l'ambassade
hard
des
feelings
États-Unis
for,
à Téhéran, l'équipé malheureuse
du président
américain qui a essayé de
Tehran,
récupérer les otages à la faveur
when
d'une expédition.
Tried
bon,
to
je crois que
get the hostages back during an action that could have been
enfin, une nouvelle, comme
led
on dit dans le Midi de la France,
very,
une nouvelle cagade.
Poor,
vous ferez traduire le mot ensuite par des...
I would call this a shitty situation.
Et les choses n'en sont pas restées là. Nous avons
this didn't stop
la persistance
there.
De, des États-Unis de vouloir
the Americans persevered
au régime des Mollahs,
pleasing
et alors
the Mullah regime
que dans la guerre Iran-Irak,
in the Iran,
la France avait clairement
Iraq
pris le parti
war,
d'Irak.
France,
la France de François Mitterrand.
Sided by Iraq, Mr. Mitterrand.
La France là-dessus a été parfaitement
invited Massoud Rajavi in France. While we were
nos
helping Iraq, our American friends helped
d'un désastre
Iran
à la faveur de ce
and
qu'on
probably
a appelé
saved them against the Iran gate.
Pas fini. Un certain nombre
and
d'années
it
ensuite,
was not over yet. Some
les États-Unis ont été un des premiers pays à coucher l'OMPI sur la liste noire des organisations terroristes.
Énième
erreur, parce
another
que l'Europe,
mistake,
qui fait beaucoup de suivi sur
Europe,
vis-à-vis des États-Unis, et
M.
Trump a raison d'ailleurs
on,
de...
The United States
aux Européens de prendre
strategy.
Un peu de distance.
And Mr. Trump is right to ask
donc,
the Europeans to take
États-Unis,
some distance.
Quand ils ont évidemment couché l'OMPI sur la liste noire des organisations terroristes ont été suivis par l'Europe et il semble de très très peu.
The Americans,
and
it took a lot of courage of organization from
the PMI to solve
this situation.
Et des légitimes revendications à l'indépendance, à la dignité et à la justice
defend
et à la démocratie
their claims for independence and
ce n'était
justice
pas
and liberty.
Fini.
But again,
en 2003,
this was not the end
les États-Unis, ce n'est pas moi qui le dis, c'est un certain nombre de journaux américains, car, Monsieur le Président, je joue sur
many
une grande
parenthèse
pour dire que vous avez, vous, une immense qualité que vous n'avez pas, que nous n'avons pas,
you
c'est que vous savez reconnaître vos torts et qu'on
you
peut
are
vous
able to acknowledge your weaknesses and your failures. For us French, it's very difficult to recognize that we were wrong. We like compliments and we don't like being criticized. But in the United States, it is possible to criticize. And this is why I'm doing it freely now.
So, thank you so much for that.
Il y a eu ce que j'ai appelé ce grand complot
so,
en 2003, où les États-Unis et la France ont conclu avec le VEVAC, la police politique, de l'Iran,
VEVAC
un accord
in
au terme
Iran,
duquel on allait mettre fin aux activités de l'OMP.
To stop the
la manœuvre se déroulait en deux temps.
It was
Iran,
to be articulated in two steps in
Iran.
Iran
sur quoi, à mon avis,
Americans who invaded
chose,
Iran, well, they should have done otherwise, but
les
it's just
Américains
my point of view. Anyway, Americans rushed
de l'armée de libération nationale iranienne,
camps,
qui étaient les unités militaires de l'OMPI.
PMOI military
passé
units.
Sans dégâts, parce qu'il y a eu tout de même
it
une
was a very
morts,
harmful
c'est fort peu
action,
dans le tableau final,
many,
mais quand même une cinquantaine de morts de l'OMPI y ont trouvé la mort.
To,
et donc, on devait normalement,
whole,
si tout se passait comme convenu, mettre fin
anyway, it,
aux activités
the aim
was to des Moudjahidines du peuple
the
en Iran.
Of the Mujahideen of the people in Iran.
Heureusement,
for us,
il s'est trouvé des militaires américains
some,
intelligents ça arrive,
very clever
qui,
American
qui n'ont pas obéi aux ordres.
Forces did
ils se sont aperçus qu'ils n'avaient pas en face d'eux une bande de criminels,
they realized that
mais
they
des
were
gens
not
qui avaient un idéal, une organisation,
but an organization with,
la conception
ideas
que la résistance iranienne avait de l'organisation politique en général, des droits de l'homme en particulier, était tout à fait la leur.
They
donc ils ont freiné,
they agreed with
ils ont
them.
Arrêté
so
et ils ont
they,
empêché que les Moudjahidines du peuple soient purement
happening
simplement
and from,
renvoyés en Iran,
sending back the Mujahideen of the people to Iran.
Quant aux Français,
where
ils ont été
well
encore pires.
To them. But French were even
ils
worse.
Ont été encore pires car
French
eux devaient mettre fin aux activités de l'état-major de l'OMPI qui est à Auvers-sur-Oise. Il y a là 150 personnes, dont d'ailleurs
in,
beaucoup de femmes, pas toujours très jeunes,
next
et
to Paris.
La police française s'est couverte de gloire
there were families
en envoyant
women,
1500 policiers et gendarmes, 1500, pour arrêter ces 150 personnes,
there to arrest
les
about
transférer
150
à Paris,
people,
les interroger,
them to
les
Paris,
mettre en garde à vue et décider de leur expulsion.
And decide where to send them and
là,
to send them back to Iran.
Ce n'est pas l'armée qui a réagi,
it was not the army there who reacted with against this, but the legal system who refused, in accordance to our legal principles,
la mesure
to
est tombée.
Expel them.
Mais il s'en est fallu de fort peu
but
à ce moment-là que la résistance ne disparaisse. Madame Rajavi a été arrêtée. Elle a comparu.
Mrs. Rajavi was arrested. She was brought to court, and the judge asked her to take off her veil, and it was ridiculous and also useless.
Ça a été Peut-être le coup d'arrêt de cette offensive, de cette
the reaction of this justice and the army stopping
le commencement this action relation,
started the beginning of
a new understanding of what pourquoi pour une simple raison, c'est que
represent
l'ONG s'est
PMI,
retrouvée avec un leader, Mariam Rajavi, qui n'a pas cédé, qui a montré
was
un
led
courage
by,
extraordinaire
Mrs. Rajavi,
à ce
who showed,
elle a
strength
tenu la maison,
and courage, and she,
et la maison ne s'est
managed,
pas écroulée. Et loin de s'écrouler, elle a pu commencer à regagner du terrain.
The organization from falling apart.
Parce que dans le même temps, bénéficiant des réseaux,
at the same time, taking advantage of
the
networks
au sein
that she has inside Iran, amongst the population, and also amongst Iranian authorities. I have proof of that, but I will not go into too much detail.
Taking advantage
of her connections there,
de la résistance iranienne au sein de l'appareil iranien,
within
on a pu
Iran,
découvrir les gens de la résistance ont pu
découvrir
que l'Iran, qui abusait tout le monde, était en train de fabriquer la bombe atomique, l'arme atomique. D'ailleurs, entre autres raisons, entre autres explications, il y en avait une qui crève les yeux de tout le monde,
one reason was obvious for everyone except for diplomats,
c'est que les activités nucléaires iraniennes se déroulaient dans des tunnels.
Because
généralement, quand on
these
fait
activities
chose dans un tunnel,
were done in tunnels under the earth, and when someone does that, it's because they have to hide something. Everyone knows that, but leaders of our governments didn't want to acknowledge it.
On a eu la preuve. La preuve
at some point,
que
we had some
l'Iran
proof
était en train de
Iran
construire la bombe atomique, les choses ont un peu changé.
And then,
malheureusement, le président américain, qui est arrivé ensuite,
unfortunately,
donc,
the next
je ne dirai
American
pas le nom
president,
parce que
I will not,
le connaît, a voulu lui,
name him because everyone knows
avoir son heure de gloire, apparaître comme
he
il
wanted,
avait eu le prix Nobel dès sa première année de
the Nobel Prize from his first year as a president.
Bon, enfin, je ne l'ai pas cité, mais tout le monde a compris.
Anyway, you know who I'm talking about, Mr.
Bon,
Obama.
Monsieur Obama a absolument voulu avoir son heure de gloire,
his moment of glory,
et son franc succès en négociant.
Decided to negotiate with Iran, but it's the kind of country you cannot negotiate with, and Mr. Trump understood that perfectly.
So, se sont un petit peu embrouillés pour beaucoup, mais M. Obama, suivi évidemment par le président français, suivi par le Premier
Obama
ministre britannique, ont conclu cet accord le 14 juillet
Prime Minister,
2015. Pourquoi d'ailleurs avoir choisi le 14 juillet? C'est pas très glorieux pour notre fierté à nous, c'est
ils
auraient pu prendre le
4
juillet,
parce que
c'est notre
national day. They could have taken the 4th of July because it would be your national day, but they choose the 14th. So we ratified this agreement, and I personally said from the beginning, without waiting for Mr. Trump, I didn't know him then, that it was a bad agreement. Why? Why was it bad? Because when you want a nuclear weapon, you need two things. You need the material, the bomb,
mais il faut le moyen de le transporter.
But also
si vous n'avez pas de vecteur pour transporter l'arme nucléaire, l'arme nucléaire ne vous sert à rien. Or, aujourd'hui, dans le monde actuel, le vecteur, ça n'est plus la composante pilotée, c'est-à-dire l'aviation, c'est ou le missile balistique intercontinental ou le sous-marin nucléaire lanceur d'engins. L'Iran n'a pas de sous-marin nucléaire lanceur d'engins et n'est pas prêt d'en avoir, quelle que soit l'affection que la Russie de M. Poutine lui porte. Par contre, l'Iran a des vecteurs, l'Iran avance beaucoup dans le domaine de la balistique intercontinentale et il a d'ailleurs pour l'aider, pour soutenir ses efforts, pour collaborer, un excellent partenaire dans la Corée du Nord.
Tout le monde sait que c'est également
un régime qui prêche la paix.
Alors,
voilà, il suffisait de se rendre compte, avoir l'obstination des Iraniens de vouloir continuer à travailler dans le domaine balistique. Ils le disent toujours que c'était bien évidemment, c'était l'eureka.
It was the sort of eureka moment from that Greek scientist,
Archimède. C'était l'eureka d'Archimède.
It was Archimedes' eureka moment.
Le balistique, Iran wanted à la capacité d'envoyer des vecteurs, donc des missiles balistiques intercontinentaux. C'était évidemment pas, je l'ai dit à l'époque, pour transporter des caisses de fromage, mais purement et simplement des engins de destruction massive.
Voilà.
Heureusement, il y a eu les élections américaines. Heureusement, M. Trump a été élu. Heureusement, M. Trump, qui n'a peut-être pas fait ses humanités dans les plus grandes facultés américaines, encore je n'en sais rien, mais en tout cas qui a cette qualité qu'on aurait cultivée chez tous les hommes d'État, le bon sens et le courage, il a évidemment découvert la poule aux œufs d'or et il a expliqué que cette politique de complaisance vis-à-vis du régime conduisait évidemment à la faillite. Il a eu beau jeu de se référer à toutes les tromperies dont le régime
s'est rendu l'auteur
à l'égard de tous les pays qui ont discuté avec lui, et nous en sommes aujourd'hui à, j'en reviens maintenant à mon point de départ,
nous en sommes aujourd'hui à ce constat que
pour la première fois depuis 65 ans, nous avons aux États-Unis, pays le plus puissant du monde, un président qui comprend quelque chose aux affaires de l'Iran.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you, Monsieur Bonnet. Over to you, Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much. The session this afternoon is to focus on the protests and the role of the opposition. I've been transfixed watching television over the last month about the volcano in Hawaii, looking at the constant tremors, the earthquakes, the explosions. And it occurred to me before coming here that that geophysical phenomenon has a lot in common, a lot in parallel with the political situation in Iran. You've seen since last December, with the massive uprising, not only in Tehran, but over 142 cities, 31 provinces, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people taking to the streets. Mitchell, you said in your opening remarks, the people have found their voice again. The 80 million population of Iran, half of them are under the age of 30. But these young people are prepared to risk their lives going onto the streets in protest. And believe me, watch what happens in Hawaii. There is going to be an eruption of volcanic proportions which sweep away this evil regime. You know, the regime, of course, has retaliated in its time-honored fashion, sending out the IRGC, its Gestapo. They've arrested 8,000 people. 14 of them have been tortured to death in prison. They then claim to the relatives and to the international press that these young people had died of drug overdoses in prison. Do you know, the people who are taking to the streets have had enough. They look at the way the mullahs have stolen their money. They look at the way that the mullahs are using the wealth of Iran to finance Bashar al-Assad, now in his seventh year of that bloody civil war, to finance the brutal Shia militias who are desiccating the Sunni population of Iraq, to finance the Houthi rebels in Yemen, to finance Hezbollah. And the people are saying, enough. You see this in the chants where they're saying, death to Khamenei, death to Rouhani, death to Hezbollah. Forget Syria, what about us? This is no longer what the Western press pretend. It's no longer a fight between the moderates and the hardliners. There are no moderates. Rouhani, because he smiles to the camera, is not a moderate, or he wouldn't be president. He is an evil monster like all the other mullahs. But one of the interesting factors arising from this series of protests, which this very week has taken place in the Grand Bazaar in Tehran, the merchants, the shopkeepers in that Grand Bazaar were the traditional backbone of this regime. But they are protesting. They are protesting at the collapse in the economy, the collapse in the rial. They can no longer afford to buy goods, to sell to the people, and the people have no money to buy the goods anyway. They are now saying we've had enough. But the interesting thing that has emerged from all this, the leaders in Iran, Khamenei himself, Rouhani, they are now pointing the finger of blame at the MEK, at the PMOI. They used to say the PMOI are an irrelevant little grouplet. They're only a nuisance. They're nothing to take seriously. Now they are saying they're behind the uprising. They are taking them seriously. Because you know they fear Mrs. Rajavi. And the reason they fear Mrs. Rajavi is because they fear democracy. They fear justice. They fear freedom. But it's interesting, you know, that whenever you get the international smell of the collapse of this evil dictatorship, then political opportunists start to slither out from under the stones of history. Last week, we saw Reza Pahlavi giving an interview to Bloomberg News. Reza Pahlavi, who for four decades has remained silent, living off the billions of dollars that his dictator father and his family robbed from the Iranian people. But now suddenly he has found his voice. He wants to be heard. He told Bloomberg News that his strategy was the reintegration of non-corrupt, non-criminal members of the paramilitary forces. This will be his new replacement regime. Well, he's going to have some difficulty finding non-corrupt, non-criminal members of the IRGC. But you know, it's time Europe followed America's lead. We heard very eloquently from Yves Bonnet how Donald Trump has torn up the nuclear deal, which was an absurdity from the beginning. Imagine signing a deal that forbade any nuclear inspectors from going into any military establishments in Iran, which of course is where all the nuclear activity is taking place. It was an absurdity. And releasing the billions of money that was tied up in sanctions, which were immediately used for rearming Bashar al-Assad, for rearming the Houthi rebels, Hezbollah, the Shia militia in Iraq. Ludicrous. Now Europe has got to stand up and be counted. Do you know our High Representative for Foreign Affairs, Federica Mogherini? She has lost all credibility since she went to Tehran, wore the veil, stood for selfies with the mullahs. And now, on the day she was there, they hanged five people. And now the mullahs are saying to the Europeans, we want you to compensate us for all the money we will lose now that Trump has torn up the nuclear deal, trying to blackmail Europe into doing this. And the European leaders are taking the mullahs seriously. Well, you know, I have a message for all those European companies who seem to have forgotten the words human rights when they try to sign these rich commercial deals with the Iranians. For every dollar that they make in Iran, they're going to lose $1,000 in America. The reality is they cannot continue to do business with this evil Iranian regime. The days of Obama's appeasement policy are over. The days of Neville Chamberlain are over. And while we were talking earlier about inviting Mrs. Rajavi long before time to America, why has she not been invited to the United Kingdom? She has been to almost every capital in Europe, but the UK are still saying she's not welcome. So the EU have got to wake up and smell the coffee. They've got to back the American position on this. The UN Security Council have got to start taking action against the mullahs for the 30,000 political prisoners who were executed in 1988, political prisoners hanged for opposing the mullahs' regime, and nothing has been done about it, one of the biggest crimes against humanity since the end of the Second World War. It's time the UN stood up and was counted as well. We, the people of Iran, and we, the people of Europe, are expecting more from our leaders. I am ashamed as a former MEP that we have a high representative like Federica Mogherini, who is prepared to go and have selfies taken. We are facing very quickly the volcanic eruption that I spoke about. We are facing the end of this regime, and it is our job to see that the PMOI, the MEK, and Mrs. Rajavi are in position to take power, to restore democracy, restore freedom, and restore justice to the people of Iran. They are praying for that day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Strong. Mr. Prime Minister, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let me speak in French because my English is too poor. Je suis toujours réconforté quand
I am always comforted when I am part of this type
parce que,
of meeting because
depuis 16 ou 17 ans que
for the past 16 or 17 years,
derrière
where
la cause,
I've been 100%
de l'Iran, de la résistance iranienne,
along the Iranian resistance, supporting them, because I consider
la cause de, que
that
défend la résistance iranienne, ce n'est pas seulement
defending Iranian resistance
cause iranienne,
is not only an Iranian cause, it's a cause
qui nous interpelle
that
tous,
is important for all of us as citizens of the world.
Il y a 70 ans, je crois.
70 years
c'est en
ago,
1939.
I believe, in 1939.
Deux gouvernements, le gouvernement français
there
et
are two governments,
le gouvernement
the French government
britannique
and the British government,
sous la direction de Daladier et Chamberlain, si je ne me trompe
under,
pas,
Mr. Daladier and Chamberlain,
sont allés à Munich.
They went to Munich.
En 1938.
In 1938.
Avec les meilleures intentions du monde,
with the best intentions in the world,
ils croyaient
they believed
pouvoir apaiser
that they were able, they would be able to appease Hitler,
de l'époque,
who was the dictator at the time,
en lui cédant l'Autriche et les Sudètes.
Giving him Austria and Sudetenland.
Vous donnez ça,
And he said, I promise, if you give me that, I won't do the war. And a few months later, Poland was invaded. And it was a start of the Second World War. What I want to say in saying this is that
les puissances occidentales
Western powers
peuvent commettre des erreurs tragiques.
Can commit tragique. Tragic errors, absolutely tragic.
Et que l'histoire
and
bégaye et a recommencé avec cette histoire
stuttering and starting over ce qu'il va dire again à chercher, with what is happening in Iran.
Parce qu'à l'époque, ce qui dominait,
at the time,
il y avait la République de Weimar qui a
what dominated, you had the Republic of Weimar
mondiale, qui était
that
la plus belle
came out of the First World War, and it was the most beautiful and the most democratic republic, and it didn't
et
prevent it from falling
Churchill,
into the hands of the Nazi power.
Guerre,
when the war started, Churchill said to
vous avez cru
both governments,
gagner la paix.
You believed that you won peace by
granting
giving away your honor, and you had both war and dishonor.
Je cite ce fait? Parce qu'il y a une
why am I mentioning this? Because I find an incredible resemblance with the attitude
que j'espère passer
that I hope is now in the past of Westerners Iranian towards Iranian resistance.
Qui est basé exactement
and it is based exactly upon the same tragic error.
En 1997,
in 1997,
il y avait l'arrivée
there was
à la présidence de la République iranienne, Khatami, qui était considéré comme étant
Iranian presidency,
un modéré.
Khatami, who was considered as
et je
ne
sais pas qui
moderate
a mis dans la tête des démocrates à l'époque.
Ils ont dit,
nous allons résoudre ce problème iranien
we're going to
en
solve
favorisant l'éclosion d'un courant modéré.
Promoting the emergence of a moderate current,
modéré,
and in order to promote this moderate current that was supposed to be embodied by Khatami, they have sacrificed Iranian resistance,
and
they have written it down as a terrorist organization.
Les États-Unis ont été suivis par le gouvernement.
The United States were followed by the
et le ministre des Affaires étrangères de l'époque, Stroh,
British government, and the Foreign Affairs Minister of the time, Stroh,
nous avons inscrit
said,
we have dans la liste des organisations terroristes
them
pour
in the list
le gouvernement
of
iranien.
The terrorist organization to appease the Iranian government and the mullahs' regimes. And this is how, for the past 20 years, we have heard thousands and thousands of words that are being pronounced left and right on the global political scene. We're talking about Shias and Sunnis, of the nuclear, etc., of economics. But we never talk about the Iranian people. It's as if they didn't exist. Mr. Stevenson
le
said earlier
des massacres de 1980,
something about the massacres in 1988
plus de 30 000
where there were more than 30,000 political prisoners in the prisons of the
prisonniers
mullahs,
qui été condamnés
and these
par
prisoners
la
had been condemned by Iranian justice
3 ans de prison,
for
3
years
10,
of prison,
15,
for 10 years of prison, for 15, for 20.
Dans cette salle,
and some of the survivors
Europe,
are actually in this room and in Europe. And they can testify to what
une
happened.
Simple fatwa,
there was
une simple
a simple fatwa
de Khomeini
from Khomeini
a fait que ces 30 000 prisonniers ont été passés par ont été pendus, exécutés.
Hung these
dans
30,
un silence assourdissant, la
in
communauté
a deafening silence,
le monde occidental, qui n'a de mots que pour
international community,
les droits
the Western world,
la justice, la paix,
who keeps wanting
bien,
justice and peace,
il s'est tu.
They stayed silent.
Ce n'est que maintenant
it's only
que l'ONU,
now that the UN,
dernier,
since last year,
ressorti cette affaire,
has dug this affair from this situation
pour la première fois,
and brought it back to the light.
L'Assemblée
and we hope
générale des Nations Unies
that for the first time, the General Assembly of the United Nations is going to eventually try the mullahs
parce que c'est un
crime
in
contre the International Penal Court,
international
because this is a crime that was committed. I'd like to
modéré
come back to the story of this moderate
des
current. How can we make such monumental mistakes at the level of the greatest world powers. We cannot have a moderate Mullah's regime.
Parce que le régime
Why?
De Mullah
because
est
the Mullah's
basé
regime is based
l'instrumentation
on
de la religion
instrumentalizing
à des fins
the
politiques.
Islam for political
Et
means.
Ce régime qui, au nom
and
de
this regime, which in the name of Islam has killed tens of thousands of Iranians, has executed them. Brutally, because they opposed its action. This regime
modéré.
Cannot be moderate.
Ne peut pas avoir un courant
it
modéré.
Cannot have Islam a moderate
qui se
current.
Définit comme étant
Islam,
la religion
which
du milieu,
is defined as being the religion of the middle,
dogmatiquement comme la religion du milieu.
In its dogma, it is the religion of the middle path. Islam detests extremes. If we have any knowledge of this religion, we cannot understand that the people killing innocents could claim to be moderate. In the Quran, killing innocents is defined as a crime against humanity.
Les Occidentaux peuvent
so how can
se tromper de
Westerners be so mistaken?
Je sais qu'ils l'ont fait
I know
les
that they did it with
monde.
The best intentions in
Mais
the
en politique,
world. But in politics, gentlemen, intentions don't matter.
Pour les églises,
that's for the mosques, that's for the churches.
Compte, c'est le résultat.
In politics, what matters is results.
Résultat. Et la politique
and the policy that was led by the Westerners and its complacent attitude towards the Mullah's regime is something that is threatening not just the Iranian people, but the whole of humanity. Because the Iranian issue is exactly that. The Iranian issue is not a question of an opposition between Shias and Sunnis. This is completely false. The best proof is of this is that who kills the most, the greatest number of Shias, it's a Shia regime. It's the Mullah's regime. So it's not a question of position. It's not a question of rivalry between this and that power, like Saudi. People are saying it's a rivalry between Saudi and Iran. Not at all.
Moi, j'ai vécu ça.
I have lived this. I have lived in the Iran of the Shah and in the Iran of the Islamic Revolution. I have heard with my own ears, I heard the Shah say in Algiers in 1975,
L'Iran sera en
1980
la quatrième et peut-être même la troisième puissance militaire et industrielle du monde.
Third
Regardez
industrial and military power in the world. See how the dictators can start
les
to believe their own fantasies.
Mullahs
are another dictatorship, and that's the tragedy of Iran.
La dictature du Shah
the
n'a
dictatorship
été
of the Shah was put down to yield it to an even more cruel dictatorship, because on top of it, it's a religious dictatorship. So the work we need to do is to absolutely reestablish the truth of the Iranian issue. And the truth of the Iranian issue is that there is a dictatorship, and you know that to better impose themselves on the people. Dictators are looking for expansion. They're looking to extend towards the outside.
Iran
has the objective written. They want to dominate the Arabo-Islamic world. They want to dominate it through destabilization. Look at what's happening. Look at the four centers of violence. Who's behind Iraq? Iran. Who's behind Syria? Iran. Who's behind Lebanon? Iran. Who's behind Yemen? Iran. So under the presidency of Boudiaf, who is the most prestigious leader of the Algerian liberation, he broke away the diplomatic relationship with Iran.
Cet
Why?
Iran-là,
because that Iran,
qu'il a soutenu matériellement,
we knew that it supported in material terms, in political terms, in financial terms, and in military terms, terrorism in Algeria.
C'est un directeur de la sûreté du territoire.
So Mr. Bonnet is the director of safety of France. He's one of the rare people who was a senior official who was alongside Algeria during the terrorist period. At that time, the French government held quiet. Even the American government left Algeria's struggle with the horrors of terrorism because it only happened to others, and we close our eyes just as the ostrich buries its head in the sand. The reality is that the mullahs have enshrined in their constitution, calling it the exportation of the Islamic revolution. It is within their constitution. They want to export what they call the Islamic revolution, which has nothing to do with Islam. And what is happening in the Gulf, they want to exclude the Saudi family from the Hejaz, which is one of the most prestigious place of the Islamic religion, to be able to dominate the world by laying hand on the Hijaz and on Mecca. So you need to realize that what we called opposition, the MPOI is a movement of resistance. It's not just a political party that is just there to fight the power in place, because the action of MPOI doesn't date back to 1979. It dates back to the Shah. And they are the spiritual sons of Mossadegh who have put down the Shah. I can tell you, I was too young at the time. The president of the Union of Algerian Students during the Algerian Liberation War went to visit the Iran of the Shah. He met Khomeini. Who presented Khomeini to him? The Shah. The Shah presented him, introduced him to Khomeini. So there are some what I call tragic errors. And these errors shows that people who apparently look antagonistic are actually in cahoots. Our duty is to reestablish this truth.
L'opposition iranienne.
Iranian opposition, what we call Iranian opposition, is Iranian resistance. We said that they're not representative, but when you have paid the price of 120,000 of its
members, there's
audio, videos, there's audiovisual documents organized by Mr. Rajavi in 1980. He would gather 500,000 Iranians in Tehran. And it is only now that this movement, which we consider as non-representative,
derrière ces manifestations, called, 142 villes.
That Khamenei says that behind these protests in 142 cities has MPOI behind them. MPOI could trigger a revolution in Iran. And this is why Mrs. Rajavi, for years and years before the agreement that Mr. Bonnet mentioned, she said, the solution to the problem is not negotiation, because you cannot trust a dictator. He can promise everything and anything to you. He will give you nothing. It is not war, because the war will serve the regime in power. She has never stopped spoken about the third way, and the third way is to leave the Iranian people, get rid of this regime, and only the Iranian people can do this. And the Iranian people only have one organization that represents them, that can be an alternative.
And,
you know, in Egypt, Egypt fell into chaos. That's what we needed to do in Libya. Libya did not have an equivalent to MPOI. If tomorrow the regime collapses, the people are there, and
disons, véhiculer les mouvements vers le positif. Maintenant, là, c'est ça.
They can swing things towards something more positive. In terms of the economics affairs, the Westerners are also mistaken.
Commémorer demain, dont a parlé Yves Bonnet. Dont a parlé Yves Bonnet.
What Yves Bonnet mentioned was just to win a contract.
Mais si
for
on veut
a
vraiment,
French company,
il faut parler de l'économie.
We need to talk about economics.
L'économie, c'est quoi? C'est les échanges.
But what is economics? It's trade. It's the importance of commercial trade between Westerners and Iran.
D'échanger.
Iran is incapable of trading except through contracts because this dictatorial political regime is incompetent. All of the money went into the pockets of the leaders. However, tomorrow, when there'll be a democratic movement which is going to manage the best interests of the people, they'll be able to develop the country and trade 100 billion instead of 10 currently.
So elle est fausse, c'est pas ça.
The current economic rationale is false, and this is what we shouldn't, use this to justify our complacency to the mullahs. I will stop this, and I'm delighted because 16 years ago, there were maybe a couple of Americans, and there were about 10 Europeans, and then the number of Europeans elected in 28 states, while the government were classifying the MPOI as a terrorist organization. These lovers of peace, where we have Mr. Stuart Stevenson alongside us.
Je vous ai dit que mon anglais était.
I told you my English was really poor.
Mon écossais.
Well, my Scottish then was really.
Ils ont été des milliers. J'ai vu grandir des milliers, d'élus, des peuples, des États.
MEPs just become thousands to support the MPOI while the government was classifying them as a terrorist organization. And now Americans are about 50. And with very high levels of, with positions in very senior positions. So they are now seeing the reality of the struggle of the Iranian people, the reality of Iranian resistance, and the stakes that are those of the Iranian people, but those of all of us as members of the international community and lovers of peace and justice.
Thank you very much, Mr. Prime Minister.